Let's go for the second speaker. We have Professor Hariyar Bhattacharya, Professor of Political Science from Wadhwan University. One can see he's a prolific writer, in fact, with an X number of books, over 100 research papers. I think the last two co-edited books will be definitely relevant to the thing that we're discussing. One is The Politics of Social Institution in India, and the very last one, The Politics of Citizenship, Identity, and State in South Asia. Both are relevant to some of the things that we've been talking. Professor Bhattacharya, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I first of all would like to thank the organizer, particularly Professor Subhashish Bhattacharya and my most revered teacher, Professor Radharaman Chakraborty, for giving me the opportunity and the great hospitality that I received here. It's amazing. I'm really indebted to it. I'm sorry that I could not be here over the last 2 days because of my occupation at the university. But nonetheless, you know, it is a fortune to be here for this day. Well, the speakers that I have heard today, they have already, they have actually prepared the background for the political scientists to intervene. So the history is almost going to be over. Now it's a turn of political science. Okay, so it's gone. Right, so. So basically what I'm going to address is the question of a different kind of unity, if you like, which I will eventually term as public culture or civic culture, which is a culture, but that is a culture which is a combination of civic and ethnic. And the other issue that I've been centrally addressing myself to is my unease with the concept of cultural unity. And I'll explain why. And I would move gradually to from cultural unity to national unity and ultimately to a different kind of space where different ethnic groups, different cultural groups, linguistic groups, religious groups, they can have a common meeting point. I will go through some of the written presentation, but when I look at my watch, I will skip. But nonetheless, the chair will be there. It's my privilege to quote, start my presentation with a quotation as a mark of respect to Swami Vivekananda. I quote, this is a quotation, small quotation taken from an essay written by Professor Chakraborty in a book which I edited. My idea as to the keynote of all our downfall is that we do not mix with other nations. We never had the opportunity to compare notes. We were upamandukas. So that's how I start. I'll come back to it. I will first of all give a global context of the issue of culture and cultural identity today. And I have in mind here the writings of Samuel B. Huntington, his famous book, Class of Civilizations and the Remaking of World Order, where he says that far-reaching changes are taking place in the post-Cold War era, globally speaking, which have immense implications for our culture, our identity, and the sense of our belonging. And he strongly stressed that gradually we are more and more clinging to our old customs, our ancestry, our religion, our language, our flags. So, well, as if it's becoming more and more ghettoized, people are clinging to whatever small identity marker they have as a kind of, you know, identification to live with. And added to that is also the other book that he wrote in 2004, that is appropriately titled, Who Are We? America's Great Debate. And there he pointed out that America is no longer the culturally homogeneous society as it used to be. And America already has given up the melting pot theory because it is a multicultural, diverse society. Many cultures, many religions, many identities, and therefore it has created for him a crisis in national identity in the US itself. So that is the global scenario, and I'll add to that by referring to the challenges that the established nation states in the West are facing today from below, challenges from below, particularly by the so-called sub-nationalist movements like the Basque and the Catalans in Spain, Corsicans in France, Wales, Scots, and the Irish in UK. So these challenges, they are also symptomatic of the same kind of problem that Huntington has hinted upon, and that is the established notions of national identity that is being challenged. And as a result of that, many other internal problems are coming to the fore. The second issue that I would like to mention here is the breakdown of the Soviet Union, which we cannot simply ignore, because that was a case of a multi-ethnic, multinational country lasting for 7 decades, but eventually we have found out it collapsed. Now, one of the factors, of course, was that it lacked democracy, that it was an example where a monolithic, undemocratic, highly centralized Communist Party proved that it was no recipe for holding such a vast multinational, multicultural country together. But my point is not there. My point is that if we look at how these great multinational states broke down, we find that they broke down in terms of nations. And this is a point which has been stressed by Eric Hobsbawm in his Nations and Nationalism since 1783, where he pointed out that Soviet Union broke down not because of nationalism, but in terms of nationhood. That is, all the post-Soviet nations like Ukraine, Uzbekistan, Kyrgyzstan, Belarus, they all call themselves nation state. They all call themselves nation state. The thing is that although they call themselves nation state, they themselves are all multi-ethnic and multicultural. So nationhood for them became the unifying force. I mean, they split from the former Soviet Union. So they are, unlike the classical model, they are the splitting nation, but eventually they also found out themselves to be multinational, multicultural, multi-ethnic. So nation became the cementing bond for these people, but nonetheless that we can hold together as nation. So these two issues I would like to mention. But when I place this global scenario, when I place the Indian records in terms of this global scenario, we find that we are actually, our records are remarkable. Our records are remarkable because we are complex, diverse country, and every author here before today, and I'm sure yesterday I must have pointed out our cultural diversity, religious diversity, social linguistic diversity is immense. This diversity is immense. I myself have written on these diversity issues for my political scientific angle. Now, the record of India in that sense is remarkable, in the sense that it has been holding itself together. I mean, it has relative order, relative peace, relative integrity, with lots of problems. So, and then it also calls for an explanation that what holds India together. This is a question not of the scholars, but it's a question of the common man. This is a question, when foreigners come to India, when we interact with them, they actually get simply, you know, confused about how such a vast country holds itself together. What is the clue? What is the model? What is behind it? If we can talk about civilizations and culture, but they're very vague terms that on the day-to-day basis, it does not hold together. That's important. So if I give one example from two recent examples from India, one is the Telangana issue in the south of India, and the other is Gokhalan here at home in West Bengal. In the case of Telangana, what we find, in a sense, is a failure of cultural unity. I mean, these Telugu people have been living in Andhra Pradesh for a long time. I mean, when Andhra was created in 1953, and since then they have been staying there, although fighting for a separate state. But if you look at it, same language, same culture, even the leadership, they come from the factions of the same people. There are two dominant groups in Andhra Pradesh, and they are actually either here or there. So The culture actually could not hold the people together. That is one example. If we come back to Burkhaland, where we find that here, of course, the cultural commonality is not as evident as there. In the case of Burkhaland, we find that here the ethnic identity of the Gurkhas, I mean, it has in history, it has gone up and down. We are all aware of it. Now, in the case of Burkhaland, the movement was very strong. Movement actually got violent. We found out that their ethnic identity became very strong. And in my conceptual distinction that I've come around to it, I have termed this ethnic nationhood. Ethnic nationhood. That is, when you don't get your fair deal, when you are not accommodated, when you are not given the appropriate space within the political system, your ethnicity, you become ethnically more surcharged. You become tense. You become ethnically more thick. And when the same group of people just now, you see that they have decided to go through the GTA, it means, in my own conceptual distinction, that there is an accommodation with the civic sphere. Civic sphere. The Gurkha Council, this is an example of a civic body, elected, democratically elected, every individual having the same vote, people there. Principle of election or nature of political power is not ascribed but achieved. They have to be elected. So this is a civic space, so they actually accommodated themselves for the moment with this civic identity space. It means a combination. If we say that this is a victory of the civic over the ethnic, it is not the case. It's a combination of the civic and the ethnic. This is the Gurkha case actually is a pointer to the kind of central argument that I'm going to make. I will explain why I would like to take ourselves from cultural unity to nationhood. You see, cultural unity, I mean, it is a diverse country. Diverse culture is more likely to fragment, more likely to give you fragmentation. I mean, if we set aside for the moment the Hindu narratives, where classical Hindu narratives, where we don't have this kind of problem, but if we take the view of culture as defined by Herder way back in the 18th century, and also which is also subscribed to by Raymond Williams in his famous book Culture, where he says that culture is lived culture. And when you say lived culture, it means it brings you plurality, it brings you diversity and all the specificities. So lived culture actually cannot guarantee that kind of unity as it is. So one has to find out some other ground where different cultures can coexist together, not simply culturally. I mean, culturally, what is the common between a Bengali and a Mizo? What is the common between a Bengali and a Naga? Or Hindus and a Muslim, a classical problem, classical issue, not a problem. So culturally, we don't have common ground. I mean, if I say that Gurkhaland, the Darjeeling is now more peaceful, Gurkhas have actually accommodated themselves within the GTA, that does not mean more cultural unity has been established between the Gurkhas and the Bengalis, because that question is not there. That was not the question. It has nothing to do with that. So the question is, cultural diversity per se, it does not produce cultural unity. It is, on the contrary, it is more likely to produce cultural fragmentation. Now, how then to have both the Nagas and the Bengalis together, Nagas and the Mizos together, Nagas and the Andhra and the Telugu together? We need a different kind of space, and that space in post-independence India has been provided by what I call the civic nationhood space. Civic nationhood space, where you have a constitution.
Civic what space?
Civic nation. Civic nation. That is, you have a democratic setup, fundamental rights, federalism, a written constitution, judicial independence. We are all aware of those civic spaces. That there is a civic space, and those are something which are not to be compromised with. But that does not mean that you have to give up your ethnic identity. So Indian model is this, that here we always find a combination at different levels of the polity. I mean, GTA is one level. State level is another level. So at different levels of the polity, we find ethnic and the civic, they combine together. it is not always a very happy combination, I'm afraid, because real situation is not so desirable. Sometimes it could be conflicting, as it happened in the case of Khalistan in the late 80s, where we found that the Sikh ethnic identity became very thick, to the point that they wanted to separate. The moment the civic was restored with the change of government in Delhi, democracy was restored, elections were restored, these people actually, their thick identity became a little thinner, and the civic space got some hold there. So it's always the case of the civic and the ethnic which have combined together in the case of India. Now, if I once again take you down to where we started, if you ask that why then the Basque or the Welsh or the Catalans or the Corsican resist or challenge the established notions of nationhood, they challenge not democracy. They do not challenge their democracy. When the Basque nationalists challenge the Spanish state authority, it's not the civic space that they are challenging. What they are challenging is the embedded ethnic orientation of the civic. What is presented as civic actually is not fully civic. Take the example of France. And France is presented as a classic case of a civic space, civic nationhood, civic nation. But they have always the so-called headscarf controversy. They have the problem with the Muslims. Why should it be? Because they find that the French so-called French civic nationhood, it actually is not bereft of ethnic element. It has the Gallic element. Same with the British or other cases. So the ethnic content within the civic, which is embedded, which is presented as a civic, is something which is resisted by various so-called subnational groups and identity groups. So in the case of India, it has happened that from the 19th century onwards, we have found that we have got a very rich tradition of thinkers. I have in mind, in particular here, Bhudev Mukhopadhyay, Rabindranath Tagore, Jawaharlal Nehru, Vivekananda, where we find the acute sensitivity to our diversity. They are all writing at length about India's diversity. Mm-hmm.